Okay. All right. I think I'm live at this point. I just need to check. Looks like I'm live. Live as I'm ever going to be. Okay, good Lord. So, it's Monday, January 16th, Martin Luther King Day observed. Excuse me, that time of time. I haven't been talking to anybody, so of course the oxygen, the lack of oxygen as I start to talk makes me yawn, so. It's not you. I would assume hopefully more people than not have the day off today. I mean, obviously I've been into some stores that were still open, so clearly not. So all I can hope for is that maybe those people are at least getting some overtime. Holiday time, whatever. That isn't just extra hours, by the way, that they actually have, like, extra per hour. You know what I mean? So, anyway, I begged off last night, yesterday's show, just between not really feeling up to par, but also having some technical issues that I was just having... One of those days, you know. So, yeah, excuse me. God damn it. You know, one of the things I'm working on, again, is working getting my Bandcamp page going. So, if you do go up onto Bandcamp and look me up, I was able to get to at least get the first album up there that you can download if you are so inclined. It just feels just like it took longer and more time than I was. This is where some of the tech issues were coming in. You know, the problem with having old graphics on media that is no longer playable on newer media. So now I've got to backtrack and try and find something that will play that I'm able to access the media that I have on various different platforms and things. So, fun times. That's kind of where I'm at now. So, you know, not as far along as I wanted to be by the end of this weekend, of course. I mean, what are you gonna do? It is what it is. Looking forward to getting back to work tomorrow and starting the process of trying to stave off the bill collectors for another fucking week or two. I'm not going to go horribly into it today. I'm basically trying to... stave off any major issues like, you know, my house getting foreclosed or them repossessing my car. Yeah, it's that bad. I mean, right now it's that bad. I can't afford to work. Welcome to America. You know, literally I can't afford to work. Because I just don't make enough. And the problem is that because of my age, I can't find other side work. Like even a fucking part-time job on a weekend. It's unfucking real. So, I mean, I'm still looking, you know, and I'm obviously putting my name up there. Trying to get my name a little further out there. Doing some voiceover work. I know it's one step at a time, but it's not going to happen overnight. I get that. It's just that it's just very frustrating. It's very frustrating to have to go through what we all have to go through just to make money to live in this country. It's like it's roadblocks purposely put in your way just because they can, you know, because they get off on it or something. I don't know. Yeah, so, yeah, it's frustrating. I'm trying not to let it, you know, really tear me down completely, because I mean, I can't afford for it to, you know. It's all I can do is try and, you know, do the thing I do and go to work, and, you know, and that's, at this point, it's like every day it's another fucking challenge over there. You know, I would just as soon, you know, get a job at a Costco or something at this point, you know, because at least I know that, like, I go to the work, I leave it at work, and then I go home. You know, the problem with the kind of job that I currently have is that it's education. So, you know, you have a certain amount of, there's a lot to think about. There's a lot to do. There's a lot that you're responsible for. And, you know, any of those balls drop, and guess what? It causes a mess. And now that said, there's also, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on, and it's just like, this year has already been too much, and it's only been 2 weeks in. So, like, what the fuck, you know? I mean, I'm really hoping that it's like one of those things where, all right, I'm going to go through the slog and go through the shit and the potholes and the metaphorical bullets whizzing by my head, so that by this time next year, maybe, I'll be doing the same thing online or radio or whatever the hell it is I'm doing in a year. And I still have a house and I still have a car and I'm able to pay my bills and everything's hunky-dory, you know. Well, yeah, I hope so. That's, you know, trying to manifest some good shit and, you know, assuming the stars are potentially, you know. Do I believe in that stuff? I mean, in as much as, like, it doesn't hurt me if I do. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't think anybody really thinks like science, from a scientific point of view, is it all like, is there any validity to it? Probably not. Of course not, on a scientific level. On a spiritual level, well, I don't know. You tell me. Spirituality is what you want to make of it for yourself, you know. And I think you can certainly spin yourself into a certain amount of delusion, and I certainly have in the past, and I'm not doing that. However, it doesn't hurt me if I potentially think about manifesting in a positive way and trying really, really fucking hard to look past, you know, a bad day or tech problems or you know, the banality of money problems. You know what I mean? And it's a banal fucking thing that we as humans have decided rules our fucking life. Is a piece of paper with a number on it, or a ledger with your name and a series of numbers on them that somehow guide your entire fucking existence. So, yeah, that's us in a nutshell. So that's happy times. This is Joe Auger, 9 o'clock. I am your bundle of sunshine here on Monday, January 16th, because that's what I do. Yeah. So, you know, tell your friends that the bundle of sunshine is online. And, like I said, it's hard for me to not respond to my day, or not to respond to my situation with happiness and light, and or, you know, the idea that, like, you know, fake it till you make it, which is I fucking hate. You know, you want to talk a pet peeve of mine when I hear people tell me that, fake it till I make it. Okay, well, I get it. I understand it. And, you know, and the whole thing about manifestation is there's a certain amount of that idea or that ideal in your head as you're trying to do that. They say, you know, pretend that everything that you want is already happening and that you're already doing it and it will potentially follow through. I get that. But there's a glibness to the way people will tell you fake it till you make it, that it doesn't. Usually that phrase is thrown at you when you're having a bad day or you're having to, you know, dealing in a customer service sort of way. You have to paint a little smile on your face in order to, I don't know, get across what it is you're trying to assist with, or, you know, you have to have the happy, happy, joy, joy when you're talking to somebody in a customer service angle. It's fucking different. I'm not good at it. I'm not really good at it, you know? And unfortunately, I'm kind of in it. So if you're going to try to tell me, like, I get it. Like, I have to have a certain amount of professionalism at work. I fucking get that. But don't tell me to fake it till I make it. Because I'll tell you right now, that goes up my ass. It's glib. It's demeaning. It's fucking, it's like gas. It's like a minor passive. It's a minor form of gaslighting, you know? In other words, you're completely negating what I'm feeling right now for whatever reason. I mean, whether it's job related, personal related, whatever, my knee might hurt like a motherfucker, and I'm trying to keep the pain receptors in my head from exploding. And you're going to tell me to fake it till I make it? How about you go fuck yourself till you make it, you know? So, yeah, I just don't say it. I say it in my head, or I say it out here because I can, you know? Anyway, yeah, don't, if you see me, don't ever tell me that. Just saying. It's just on the Instagrams, on the YouTubes, it's just a warning. You may get it back to you full face. You know, I may throw that right back at your face if you tell me that. I'm just, again, I get it's an Achilles heel. I'm a realist on a lot of levels, which, you know, flies in the face of me trying to manifest. You know, I mean, but part of the whole idea of manifesting is that you're kind of getting up off your ass and you're trying to move things forward, you know, in a visceral physical way where one has to do a certain amount of work or legwork or research or fixing technical problems or whatever the fuck it might be. I mean, that's not manifesting. That's physically trying to move shit forward. You know, the idea of the manifesting is sort of it's kind of the replacement of ambition. You know, at my age, the ambitious part of me, especially when it comes to music or the creative arts or performing and all the things that I, you know, that have led me on this path, that ambition's gone. I mean, it really fucking is. I mean, especially, you know, there was an ambition before I was making any money at it, you know, that spurred me on. And then it sort of slowly started the pinprick of reality hit me in 1985 when I really got a real clear view of the music business and how fucking awful it is. How real it is and the reality of that. So I think that's why I'm a realist. This is like, I really try not to blow smoke up people's asses. I don't care who they are. I don't care if they're in a position to borrow me or not. I'm just not gonna. It's like, look, motherfucker shits and pisses like I do. So I don't care how much money, or I don't care what his numbers look like on the ledger. Cause doesn't mean anything. Doesn't mean he's better off than me. Doesn't mean I'm better off than him. Other than the fact that, you know, in this society, he's better off than me. Yeah, that sucks. You know, but that is the reality. So trying real hard to, you know, do what I can. Like, you know, canceling last night, I felt guilty, which I don't want to do. You know, I mean, again, it's like the whole point of me doing this is that I don't want to feel bad about it. I want to, this is meant to be a place where I can be kind of positive and try to work through shit. I mean, again, it's a daily vlog. I am trying to work through stuff. Partially is what it's about. what's going on in my thought process and all that kind of shit. And you know, for those who want to hear it and maybe you get some inspiration from it or not, however, that's up to them or you. You know, the few people that are kind of trickling on. All I can do is just kind of you know, verbally whatever and then go from there until, you know. So not much to other than the fact that it snowed a little bit today, you know, I suppose, which was slightly exciting. You know, otherwise just um I was thinking something happened today. What the hell was it? I don't remember what it was now. It must not have been that important or anything. Doing my regular errandy kind of things, and then kind of getting back home today. And it's like I'm kind of still fighting a little bit of fatigue today, which I don't kind of understand, because I've actually been getting, knock wood, I've been getting sleep past, maybe, and that's mental, maybe I'm getting too much sleep now. It's like I can't win either way. I either have too little sleep or too much. But I want to say I want to say it's almost been a week, like 7 full days of like, we're talking like a good 7-8 hours of sleep. I haven't done that in, I can't remember how long now. And again, I have to somewhat attribute it to, you know, kind of really by necessity, because I don't have the money, of cutting down on the caffeine drinks, I think. I mean, you know, I'm trying to put two and two together for sure. You know, I mean, I even had a Coke the other day, and, you know, just to satiate the sort of, you know, the craving. And, you know, I've always wanted to kind of get that particular addiction in control, more in, you know, in better in control like that, like being able to just say, hey, I'm gonna have a Coke today, and then that's it, and then I don't have another one for a while. You know, it's been a long time coming to be able to do that, where I don't buy Coke. I mean, it's the same thing. Like even today, going shopping, it's just like if I see, you know, the little thing of Coke in a glass bottle, like the small glass bottles. I mean, that's like the best way to have it, right? And thing of it is, it's like, well, I don't know, A, didn't have the money to buy it, and B, it's like, man, do I need it? No, I really don't. So on some levels, not having the money, somehow I'm sleeping better even when I don't have enough money. I don't get it, dude. Yeah, it's just weird. Very strange. So trying to keep those addictions at bay, of course, on a day-to-day basis is always a fun thing. So one thing I am thinking of doing, though, like I need more projects in my head that are unfinished. One of the things that, you know, I'm looking into doing, obviously, is doing voiceover work. And looking at Audible.com has a thing where you can upload and publish your own audiobooks and stuff like that. And, you know, but you can also put your work up there, your sampled work of your voice or whatever. And, you know, if people have their own publishing thing that they need some sort of voiceover work, done, you know, you put your samples up, as I'm doing, trying to do again, you know, trying to finish doing that. And hopefully people will hear it, and they, and you know, the potential of getting some extra work that way. So, you know, again, it's one of those things. It's like, you know, one wishes this was a movie montage where the inspirational music is happening, and you see me doing all of these things, the technical things, and the typing, and the getting the stuff and the feelers, and doing the job, and you know, the interviews, you know, the job. You know, getting the resume, all that's the montage, right? It's like I'm still in the montage phase, I should say. And I'm waiting for the montage phase to be over with so that I can actually get whatever the work I'm trying to do. Anyway, so yeah, part of that voiceover work is the thought process of, like, so if you look up on audible.com, I mean, there are tons of people publishing, which, you know, is the first thing that comes to my mind is Andy Warhol saying that we're all going to be famous for 15 minutes. I think he's right. I think he's completely right. way ahead of his time and his thinking. But I thought if I were to write a short book of some sort, it wouldn't be as much as I've tried my hand at like science fiction-y kinds of work, I don't know if I would do that. My first thought was, to be honest, because so other people have done something sort of similar, some similar things, it would be a good jumping off point if nothing else, but would be to do a book about my sobriety, about my journey, as far as that goes, like, you know, where it all started, you know. And I know where I would start it, like, it came into my head as like what the first, you know, what to, like the first line of the book would be. And I'm not going to tell you here, because especially if it happens, oh, I don't want to spoil it, make you buy it. So the idea would be that I would, and it wouldn't be long. Like, it would be like, you know, 80 to 100 pages. It doesn't need to be long, because it's meant to be somewhat of a help, more of a helpful, I don't want to say self-help, because it's not really self-help. It's just more like, this is what I did. If something that I did, or 20 years later, the things that I've gleaned and or continue to use as a thought process as regards my sobriety, then, you know, maybe it's worthy to do. Maybe it's worthy to put on the quote-unquote printed page, metaphorical printed page. And then the idea would be, so I would publish it through Amazon. But I would also do the voice, you know, the audiobook of it as well. I can certainly create my own damn cover in Photoshop. That's not a big deal. And then what happens is that, you know, if people do download it, then you get royalties. And depending on, you know, who knows? You know, it's, again, all pie in the sky here. This is all just a fucking Hail Mary pass as far as I'm concerned at this point. I mean, you know, certainly don't have much to lose. So, you know, ideas and things are percolating, and I think it's the first time in a while, in a way, that things are percolating on the creative end of things, as they are 2 weeks into January. You know, again, this starting kind of with what I'm doing with this daily vlog thingy online that I started in December. So, you know, I'm just trying to exercise all the various aspects of what I do, or can potentially do. Like, you know, one of the things today, you know, was I was finally able to get some work, some forward momentum in getting so the album I had been working on to get up on Bandcamp is the Invisible Years album that was released back in 2001, even though it has its roots, originally started recording this and conceived of the album in 1985, when I first was really starting out. You know, 1985, I was 20 years old. It's the first real. I had done two cassette releases before that, one called Meander Man and another one called Nothing's Here to Stay, and those were done. I want to say, what was it, 80, maybe 83 and 84 or something like that. And this album has its roots in 1985. Some of the bits and pieces of the recordings still date from when I was using an old Fostex 4-track cassette machine. So some of those tracks actually made it to the final record. You know, definitely is a certain patina regarding how those things sound still, but that was all purposeful anyway. So the record was started, you know, as it would have been my third project, big project, but it's the first real kind of album that has a, in my mind anyway, has a real kind of follow through, as a real concept. Is the most sort of cohesive in that regard, or at least the first, you know. And it's also still, I was just listening to it today because I had to tweak the files and things before I could put them up on Bandcamp and make sure everything was hunky-dory with them. So I wanted to make sure that I was listening to them first before I shot them up there. So I listened to the record for the first time in a while, and it's sort of like, you know, for what it is, which is basically kind of like psych folk Prague songwritery stuff, you know, very earnest in its delivery for sure. Still kind of a creepy, a bit of a creepy listen. You know, it's definitely got some creepy moments on there. So it's up there. It's up there now. So I'm going to eventually put a PDF of all of the artwork on there, since, again, I don't have actual physical copies of this. But, you know, there's a little insert here with, you know, like a little kind of gatefold thing, and then the tray card with the information and all this kind of stuff. So, you know, those are all things that I want to just make available to whomever the hell wants them. You know, I doubt that there will be physical copies of that. You know, listen, unless someone really was like digging it and wanted to pay for a full-on vinyl version of it, that sounds good to me. You do that, but you know, I'm not holding my breath over that one. So trying to do that. So the next one, again, you know, I gotta work on is the Taken Orally project, which again is another, which would have been the next solo thing that started its life in 1995. Seeing as how in between 85 and 95, I was mostly doing band work. I was in a band called New and Improved, which then changed over to Curio, and then went into a different band called Blackbird 13, and then also Meatballs Fluxus. So between 85 and 95, it was mostly bands that I was in, you know, and producing in a little bit. And then come 1995 is when Taken Orally started its journey. If we're looking back, even though that wasn't released until, I think, 2007 or something like that. So sort of slowly happening. But, you know, baby steps. That's all I can do, is just kind of move forward as I can, and hope that the day, unlike yesterday, doesn't really throw me off too difficult, or too hard, whatever. Sometimes it does. So, you know, again, this week, start tomorrow and Wednesday, and probably Thursday, depending on how I'm feeling, I probably won't be back until Friday, because it's a half day for me, so I'll have Friday night off, and then Saturday and Sunday, we'll see, you know, how things go, you know, again, under the assumption I'm still in a house, you know, kind of thing. Yeah. Here's a story. So I'm drinking cranberry juice, and I think I've mentioned this before, doing these things, that back in 2020, the year of COVID year, when we were all kind of in lockdown and all that kind of stuff, and the whole thing about, you know, COVID. Basically taking your sense of smell and taste away. And so, I cranberry juice has always been a good antioxidant for me, and it's also been really good for whenever I do studio work, especially singing. I will always have cranberry juice with me, because it tends to clear things out a bit, you know. But the thing with 2020 with COVID is that I wanted something that had a very, you know, very, something very tart, very, you know, something very, you know, nothing, something that didn't have like a real kind of neutral kind of taste, something that was going to be like, I either taste this or I don't, you know. So cranberry juice was my go-to, especially like on the every other day when I had a sniffle. I thought, oh, fuck me, I got COVID. Let's do some cranberry juice. Do I still have a sense of smell and taste? Oh, okay, that's good. That's all good. But I, you know, then have just been like, you know, and it's got to be the 100% one, not the diet one, not the cocktail one. It's got to be this one. So I was, of course, you know, trying to go to different stores that are, so it's cheaper, and all this. And so the Stop and Shop, there's also, you know, Market Basket, which is marketedly cheaper than Stop and Shop. but they don't have the Ocean Spray 100% cranberry juice. All they had was the cocktail, which is not what I want, you know. But there was a Market Basket version of the 100%, and it just, like, just didn't do it. Just doesn't do it. So I had, sure enough, I had to go to the Stop and Shop today, get the 100%, and that's what I'm drinking there, or the Blood Red, whatever. And, you know, so what this does is, of course, when I drink the cranberry juice, in my mind, it's like, and this is the sobriety, or the aspects of being a recovering alcoholic come into play. That's kind of a major drink of choice these days. Certainly a lot healthier than soda or anything like that. But, you know, the back of my mind, would I want to put some vodka in that puppy and make a cranberry, you know, refresher of some sort? Damn straight I would. Just not gonna, you know? I can't remember, but it's been a long time. But I remember a day where, you know, there used to be alcohol in the house before I stopped drinking. I mean, I'd have stuff up in the cupboard, you know. And it's been a long time, obviously. You know, we're talking almost 21 years now. And at one point, I even thought, it's like, you know, I'm going to keep alcohol in the house, even though I don't drink it, because it's a perfect way to, well, at the time I thought this, it's a perfect way to really make sure that I'm okay. Then I thought better of it on a particularly bad day when I thought the bottle's right there, I could just go for it. Yeah, I think, okay, maybe I need to get the bottle out of the house. This was many, many years ago at this point, obviously. But, you know, my thinking was potentially a little flawed, I think. I think a little naive is the way of looking at it. So, long story short, I think, you know, as I was saying, one of the things that I would put in the book about my sobriety would be these kinds of things. It's the fact that, because I have not seen anybody really write about this aspect of so getting sober or and all that stuff. I don't see people talking about it. And any of the stuff I've seen online, or people just talking about their sobriety. You know, I see people, what they talk about is that when any, like, if they've got the thought in their head that suddenly they've got to go to a fucking meeting or they've got to call their sponsor or whatever it might be, that somehow they're going to fall off and be problematic. And I'm like, in my head, I'm going, really? Okay. I mean, if you're really in trouble, sure, maybe I can see it. But 20 years in, if you're, you know, in good shape with it, my first thought is, it's like, and I've had this thought for a long time. And I've said this before as a thing that I would certainly put in writing. And it would be that if you have the thought in your head that you want to drink and you want to drink every fucking day, but you don't, then you've won. I say that with quotes, because the minute you say you've won is potentially a red flag saying, oh, that means I'm okay, I'm fixed. Well, no, you're never fixed. But the thing of it is that you've won over that feeling for today. You know, and I think that's important. And I think a lot of people don't. I see a lot of people not talking that way about it, about their sobriety. Like, you know, dude, if I get through the rest of this day without drinking, then I've won the fucking game. You know. Now, have I thought about drinking today? Huh? Did I think about it yesterday? Fuck sure. It was a shitty day yesterday. I thought about it. Yeah. Because it goes through your head, because that's how one has conditioned oneself over many, many years of drinking. Whether it's been 21 years of me not drinking, it doesn't matter. The programming is really pernicious. It's really deeply embedded. It takes a long time to pull as much of it out of there, but I don't think you ever really are able to pull it fully out. So you just live with what you have left. So the idea is that, yes, I have the thought process. I want to go get a drink. I want to drink today. But then I just don't. I don't follow through. That's all. I do something else, or I drink something else that's non-alcoholic, obviously. You know, do I then go to drink something that's potentially just as sort of bad for me, like too much caffeine? Yeah, sometimes. But it's not going to impair me, you know, like alcohol. That part I'm working on for sure. But I just don't see people talking about that. Like, what happens is the thought process after the fact of having that thought. You have the thought, you want to drink, and then you don't. And then no one talks about it. It's like it just sort of like, oh, we don't, you know, it's almost like a taboo subject. From there, it becomes a situation of, I think it's really important to talk about to yourself, if nothing else, that it's okay to have the fucking thought on a day-to-day basis. And somehow I'm paused. I think I'm back. Sorry. My Instagram's acting funny. Anyway, as I was saying, that you have the thought, you just don't do anything about it. You don't follow through with it. And that is okay. That's part of the process, is that you just acknowledge the devil in the room. You know, you look over your shoulder, he's sitting right there, and he's got the little, you know, snifter or whatever the hell, just saying, hey, want a drink? And you look over and say, I'd love one, but I'm not gonna. Thank you very much. You acknowledge the devil in the room, and then you turn around. That's all. And that's it. You know, it's up to you to activate the devil. The devil has nothing to do with it. It's up to you. And so I think I just don't hear enough people talking about it. So if I were to have an angle to the book, it would be that. So we'll see. We shall see. I think on that note, I've talked long enough about sobriety for the day and about technical problems and whatever the hell else. So I'm going to play a little bit. I do have to work in the morning early, so I'm probably not going to go too late tonight. So I'm going to... And yesterday, like I said, yesterday I was not in a good place, really. I was just wasn't feeling up to snuff at all in any way, shape, or form to do kind of any kind of anything, talking, performing, whatever. Let's see. I'm going to try to find something here that popped into my head. It's been a while since I've played it, but I think I probably could. Let's see. Maybe it wasn't that one. Sorry. Sorry, I'm doing this way on the fly here. Like I said, I didn't really. That's not it, man. That's really not the fuck it. Yeah, it's stuff. Yeah, I'll need to come back and look at these. Otherwise, I'll take all night just looking at a fucking screen. is it getting better? Well, do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you now? You got someone else to blame. You say, bad taste in your mouth. You act like you've never had love, and you want me to go without. Well, it's too late tonight. You drag the past out into the light. Go. Have you come here for forgiveness? Have you come to raise the dead? Have you come here to play Jesus? To the lepers in your head? Did I ask too much? You gave me nothing, well, now it's all I've got. You're one, but we're not the same. But we hurt each other and we'll do it again. And you say, love is a temple, love a higher law. One of U2's better pieces of work, I think. Mm. Saying capo first fret. I don't know if I believe that or not, but we're gonna try it. This one should be easy enough, but I haven't played it in like forever, so I'm cheating, right? I'm cheating from myself. Here we go. I've known for a long time the kind of girl you are, from a smile that covers teardrops, the way your head yields to your heart. Of things you kept inside that most girls couldn't bear. I've known you for a long time, but I've just begun to care. Well, I've known of all the heartache, and I've known of all the pain. I've seen you when the sun shines, and I've seen you when it rains. I've seen you make a look of love from just an icy stare. Nesmith song called Propinquity, I've Just Begun to Care, and actually written before his Monkees days, but then recorded much later. Let's see. Yeah, only marginally prepared tonight, so what are you gonna do? Is what it is. There you go. All right, take that off. see if I can do this one. It's a Peter Gabriel song called Washing of the Water. Hang on. Am I live? Am I still live? It's saying no data, and then it's back. Because that's what it does. River, river, carry me on. River, river, carry me on. River, river, carry me on to the place where I come from. So no, that's interesting. Is it this? I'm looking for a specific lyric. and there's multiple versions because it's sort of a traditional it's got so many different multiple versions of it over the years. Interesting. I can't find the one that I'm looking for. Yeah, it's interesting. There's so many new different versions of it with so many different. Yeah, I'm gonna wait on that one too. But I'm gonna think about it. I'm gonna put it on the pile of ones to look at because I'd really love to do that one. It's been a while since I've done that. So actually, in its place, I can do one that I know I can do, and haven't done much. That's sort of in its similar kind of vibe, obviously. I need a capo for this one now. I believe it was it two or was it three? It was two. So, so long story short, I was wanting to do O Death because it popped into my head to maybe try and do it because I actually did a cover of it on this album that I made available up on Bandcamp. So my version is up there, but my version sort of takes the form of the cover version that was done by a band called Kaleidoscope back in 1967. Their guitar player at the time was David Lindley, who is his own dude, but they were sort of kind of a psych folk aggregate from California, and I like my favorite of that song is theirs. So I did a version with their lyrics. Now their lyrics are a little bit different than some of the others I've seen and am seeing. I think there's like multiple, just people have written their own verses of it over the years. The most recent version of it that I became famous was on the Wherefore Art Thou soundtrack, done by Jim Stanley, I think it was. Stanley Brothers, excuse me, sorry. And anyway, so, but I want to try and find the lyrics. I don't remember the lyrics. I wish I did. I just need to write them down. But I'll look at that one. But this one is similar. Also a cover done by the band in 68. I do their version sort of it. And it's, again, similar in tone, shall we say. They call it Long Black Veil. Ten years ago, on a cold, dark night, there was someone killed beneath the town hall light. There were few at the scene, and they all did agree that the man who ran looked a lot like me. The judge said, "Son, what is your alibi?
was near, she stood in the crowd and shed not a tear. Sometimes at night, when the cold wind moans in a long black veil, she'll cry over my bones. She walks these hills in a long black veil. She visits my grave when the night winds wail.
Let's see. Let's do something else. What are we going to do here? Thank you for hanging out. For those that are here, either in lurk mode or otherwise. And it's a thing that I do if you're just sort of passing through. I just kind of play. Hopefully people are interested or not, and, and that's fine. I'm going to do another, let's see, maybe not that one. I actually just did that one. Sorry, let me just see which other one I want to do here. Like I said, I hadn't fully prepared today, because I was just working up till start time on some, the other technical stuff I had to do. And I had to get that kind of done and out of the way before. So I needed to make it look, or I needed to kind of try to get something accomplished. You know what I'm saying? Let's see. I've done this one a few times, but I like it, and it's fun to play, sort of, and it's from one of my favorite songwriters, being Andy Partridge.
The ones who broke their hearts, the disappointed, all congregated my house. Their voices sob with grief that they want to be the chief of the tribe with broken hearts. Once I had no sympathy for those destroyed and thrown away by love.
Oh boy, did I fuck that up. Oh, I'm so sorry. Wow. That bridge is a bitch. I apologize. Sorry. That's what it was. Yeah, see, the bridge goes from a B minor to a G, F sharp sus to F sharp minor 7, D, G sharp minor to E. That's a bridge. That's Andy Partridge's bridge. And it always throws me. I'm going to try this song from the beginning. as I've said to you, this is a disclaimer, I'm rehearsing in front of y'all, so I apologize if I fuck it up. So thanks for hanging out and being kind. Tonight, guys, like I said, the voice is having some issues. Was having issues yesterday, so it's a little better today, but I gotta be careful what I pick here, apparently. So I'm gonna do a couple more just, and then I'm gonna leave it for the night, make a short night of it, since again I do have to wake up earlier. I have to get up early to go to work in the morning, you know, the things you have to do. So let me see. No, I'm not going to do another Nesmith song because especially that particular one has a ton of falsettos, which I'm having some trouble with tonight. So, yeah. Ooh, excuse me. No, that's good. That's pretty high in the range there too. Yeah, you know, so it's one of those things. I'm just trying to find maybe one more song that I can play that's not, you know, too out of whack. Excuse me. still live, right? Yeah, okay. Just making sure. Let's see. I could do that just because I can. All right, I'm going to do two more. I'll do my one more, and then I'll do my end song as usual. And I'm going to do this one. They're kind of connected via Python in some ways, but this first one is my favorite Neil Innes song, so hopefully I can do this some justice tonight. Sorry, guys. Frog in throat. Okay. Let me see. Let's see. All right, I'm going to do one more. I'm going to do another Nesmith song because I feel like I want to try and redeem myself a little bit, if it's possible.
touched your hand and told you that it really was a lie. And though you never knew it, dear, I cried.
That's another one I haven't done in a while, but it's potentially one of my favorite Nez tunes, so. All right, I'm going to end it off my last regular tune as usual. Tomorrow, I'm going to be taking Tuesday, Wednesday off. I'm going to try to do a Thursday night show. I'm just going to keep saying I'm going to try. I do have to work the next morning, but I have I'm in Providence that night, so it's an easier commute, so that I get home a little earlier, a little bit of time to kind of get my shit together and all that kind of wonderful stuff. So, potentially Thursday night. We'll see what happens. Anyway, on that note, let's put everything into perspective again, since we got to work. The work week starts tomorrow. Put it all in perspective for those moments where we fucking will need to. Anyway, just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it's reckoned a sun that is the source of all our power. Sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour in the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. Bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. With 30,000 light years from galactic central point, we go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is one of only millions and billions in this amazing and expanding universe. The universe itself keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light, you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere up in space, cause there's bugger all down here on Earth. Present company excluded. And on that note, I will leave you to it for the rest of your evening. I gotta go make sure my cat has eaten his dinner. I got to get my shit together for tomorrow morning because I got to wake up early and cover for someone else who isn't going to be in. And God knows what the universe is going to throw at us tomorrow. So who knows? Maybe one of these days it'll be Jubilee, friends. For those of you who don't know what Jubilee is, go ahead and look it up. I can actually give you the definition term. Well, Jubilee, I guess, has a number of different terminologies, shall we say. So if we're talking about Christianity and we're talking about Jubilee, it basically says that the year of Jubilee, which came every 50 years, was a year of releasing people from all of their debts. So, been a lot longer than 50 fucking years since any of us have been released from our debts. So, I tell you what. Believe me, this is not a religious thing. I am not Christian in any way, shape, or form. Was a Catholic, no longer practicing. However, the idea of Jubilee being that every 50 years that everybody's debts gets canceled and we start fresh. How about 2023? We call it, and it rhymes and everything. 2023, year of Jubilee. Let's think of that. Let's maybe see that if the powers that be will go for it. After, they'll just wipe all the debts of free. That might be nice. It'd be a good year to do it. We've had a long go of it, and COVID hasn't helped. So let's think of 2023 as the year of Jubilee, shall we? Starting tomorrow. On that note, as my voice cracks into infinity, I'm going to let you go. Thanks for hanging out, as always. And I will, again, probably, hopefully see you on Thursday. That is the 19th already, January 19th. That's fucking crazy. That's where I'll see you next. So please be safe. If the roads are slick in the morning, I don't know what's going on weather-wise, but, who knows. See you later.